All right, so this is episode 7 of the Behind a Bulldog podcast. As always, the Behind a Bulldog podcast is available on Anchor, Breaker, Google Podcasts, Radio Public, Spotify, and of course the Wingate Bulldogs YouTube channel. And today we have a very special guest. It is Philip Poole from the class of 2004 here at Wingate. Philip, thank you so much for taking some time out of your busy day and joining me for episode number 7.
Oh, thanks for having me, Sam. It's a pleasure.
So you recently were given the title full-time goalkeeper coach for the U.S. Women's National Team. We saw the article that Mr. Sherwood wrote last week, but just wanted to hear from you again and get your reaction from getting that opportunity with the U.S. Women's National Team. Congratulations, first and foremost.
Well, thank you. Thank you. No, it's a really cool situation. It's a great honor. There's a lot of things that go into it, and I think ultimately you step back and say that the chance to work for the best team in the world currently, the best team in the world historically, there's a lot that goes into that, but it's an amazing group of people, it's an amazing organization, and I'm just fortunate and lucky that I get the chance to try and help us win Olympic gold medals and World Cup championships and everything in between. So it's a real honor.
And correct me if I'm wrong, you've been involved with U.S. soccer part-time for a number of years now. Is that correct?
Yeah, I've been involved, Sam, since about 2012 in different capacities. So whether it be working with their junior national teams, whether it be working for their scouting department, even had a spell in their coaching education department. So I feel like I've got a really good handle on the organization as a whole. Yeah, and then an opportunity like this comes along, and I feel like I'm fairly well suited for it, and I feel like I've got a fairly good hold on where we're at right now. So again, really, really fortunate, really honored to get this opportunity.
And then in regards to your daily responsibilities, I know obviously everybody's dealing with the coronavirus pandemic. So since taking this job as the goalkeeper coach, What has your day-to-day been like right now, given the circumstances?
You know what, Sam? I heard this on another podcast, and I think a lot of us coaches want to appeal to other coaches and different things. And to be honest with you, my day-to-day has changed a lot. And I think first and foremost, I think it's actually been, I feel really for players, and there's so many people that have been affected by this. But for me personally, to pause for a little while and come up for some air and spend 10 times as much time with my family. So for me, my day-to-day has been affected like everyone, and there's some terrible things have gone on. But personally for me, Sam, it's been a chance to spend a lot of time with my kids, a lot of time with my wife, try and take some of the burden off what she's doing. So for me, there's a lot of conversations with players, there's a lot of conversations with coaches, whether it be our coaches or GMs of the pro clubs, a lot of video work, whether it be clipping or scouting. So a lot of busy work. But honestly, I think that the coach's line is supposed to be, well, I've been busy, I've been edgy. I've actually enjoyed taking a breath and pausing, because what obviously, you know, talking to coaches out there and people that are working in the sports industry, it's to say it's 24/7 is an understatement. So this has been a nice change of pace, and I'm, you know, coming down the line, you can see it kicking back into 24/7, 365 again. But yeah, just a lot of work. But again, it's been a little bit of a curse and a blessing for me personally. So
nice. Yeah, no, it's been a challenge for all of us. But you're certainly right about the family time is very important. Where are you coming from, by the way? Are you still based in North Carolina or where?
Yeah,
are you?
I'm still based in Charlotte, North Carolina for now. You know, and again, a blessing and a curse, right, with everything that's going on in the world. So we've never lived anywhere outside of North Carolina, my family and I, and proud to live here in Charlotte. And it's nice to be close enough to Wingate to stop by every now and again to see everyone. So
that's awesome. All right, now we'll transition over to Wingate, class of 2004, like I mentioned earlier. And you said in that article that the first time you arrived to the United States was when you were a freshman on campus at Wingate back in the day. So tell me what you remember about the first time that you heard about Wingate and why you ultimately decided to come.
Well, I had probably, so to paint the picture, I'll give you a little bit of context. I'd never actually been on the internet. And it's not like I come from, you know, the wild, wild west out there, but I've just never been on the internet. I never Googled or researched anything. And I had 12 different offers to come here to this country. And of all the coaches, something about Coach Gary Hamill struck me. I had no knowledge of Division One, Division Two, and none of it, because again, I'd never been on the internet. I'd heard about a couple of people had come out to the United States and enjoy the experience. So I really liked my conversation with Gary, and I think the difference in the way he did it, and he's very shrewd. Obviously, you've seen by his recruitment of international players, some of them ridiculously good, is the conversation was about soccer. It was about what his team needs. It was about how the soccer can be, you know, a vehicle to change in your life. And for me, that's what, you know, a soccer player wants to talk about soccer. So the other thing about coming here, Sam, was we watch a lot of American television, a lot of American films, right? So I think I watch these television shows that are based in New York or LA, and these big, you know, movies where you see everything. I'm like, it's not going to be quite that, but it's going to be maybe a smaller version. So I remember I flew in to Detroit and hopped on a plane down to Charlotte, and then I remember driving out the airport, and I'm like, okay, this is all right. And then you get towards, you know, 45. I'm like, all right, it's fine. Then 74, and I'm like, it doesn't look like it looks like in the movies. And then the further through Monroe, and then even the lights of Monroe, you're like, okay. And then you get through it and past Hilltop. And I remember thinking, this is strange. And then, you know, that was my first experience. And I just, it took me a couple of days. I wasn't disappointed. I wasn't anything. It was just, I had this expectation of where I was going and what it was going to look like and what it was going to be like. And, you know, I'm sure I'm not the first person that's happened to. And I actually read something, a classmate of mine and a teammate of mine, Paul Kostick, he was in one of the alumni magazines, or and there was a profile about him, and he's just opened a brewery in Atlanta. And I remember he said something about when he came, the brochure said 20 minutes outside of Charlotte. I'm not sure 20 minutes, maybe if you fly, but it's one of those. So we always laugh and joke about that sometimes when we get together, you know, like that drive from the airport down 74 was interesting. But yeah, that was my first experience of being in this country. And it was Gary Hamill, just the conversation and the talk about soccer that got me here. So
that's it's funny you bring that up, 20 minutes outside of Charlotte, because I certainly felt the same way when I was driving to campus for the first time. Now, given that was 3 years ago, but still very, very funny you mentioned that. What do you remember about the specifics of the conversation that you had with Gary Hamill when you first got to campus? What were the memories of that first conversation face to face?
I can remember it like verbatim, right? Like they just come off a very successful season. He sort of referenced there were some areas that he thought, as good as they had been, they could have been better. You know, he talked about he feels like he has a good core for the future. He wants a player to potentially impact for 4 years, those kind of things. And one thing about him was he was very, he was always very honest and upfront and open about it might not be easy. There might be some bumps in the road. There may be some things that pop up here or there, but, you know, keep your head down, you know, focus on your soccer and your school, and if there's anything that you need, there's a lot of people here to help you. And really it was along the lines of that. And to be fair, it wasn't a sales pitch, because he'd have that talk in sophomore years and junior years and seniors and honestly subsequent years after that. And he's someone that, you know, when I've got a big decision to make or when I've got an opportunity, he's someone that I've called a ton of times to say, hey boss, you know, you want the best for me, what do you think about this? Is this the right thing? And there's not many people in your life that would say, hey, Paulie, this is not right for you. I wouldn't do it. You know, most people are going to tell you what you want to hear. So that honesty's kind of stayed constant throughout. So yeah, I remember that conversation really well. And there was obviously a few jokes in there and some things that I won't repeat, but that's just who he is. He's amazing.
Yeah, no doubt. Just such an incredible personality and a legend on this Wingate campus. A guy who's been here for nearly three decades, won a national championship, of course, in 2016. But like you said, success began in the early 2000s. And when you think about it, you won two SAC championships in your time at Wingate. What do you remember most about the teams that you were on while you were here on campus?
You know, I remember a couple of things. You know, we always had a nice mix, right? We had a really good core of foreign players. We had a really excellent core of domestic-based players. And, you know, the best teams I played in over that 4 years is when we kind of got it mixed and we kind of integrated well. That wasn't the case all of those 4 years. There was a couple of years where it didn't mix and it didn't gel, or for whatever reason. But I think I look at those teams and I go, there was a heck of a lot of talent. You know, obviously people at Wingate or people that have been through Wingate understand that, you know, sports just aren't fully unlimited funded, or they didn't used to be. So, you know, the fact that Gary could get rosters of such talent and having to spread a bunch of money around was phenomenal. I don't know how he did it, and I don't know how he still does it. I mean, he does an amazing job in his recruitment. So I think the years when it was gelled and it was a little tighter as a unit were the better years. And I look at, I think my sophomore year, we started a little shaky and then went on a 10 or 11 game win streak. And, you know, that was probably the best group that we had in terms of we could defend, we could score, we could win games, we could come back in games, we could see games out. So yeah, that was a good memory. But those teams that gelled and those teams that were tight were the most fun to play on. And you know, there's always a lesson you take away, right?
Right. Philip, when did you find out that being a goalie was right for you? Did Gary immediately put you there? What's the backstory on that?
No, I think it's one of those positions in the game where you probably start out at 8 or 9 years old and you don't really deviate. So came to Wingate as a goalkeeper. And you know, that's something that's been there the whole time. And it's like saying, you know, coming to Wingate as a linebacker and ending up being a player's kicker. You know, it's one of those things that just doesn't really happen. So yeah, I think in general with goalkeepers, I think when you're a goalkeeper, it's been, you know, for 10 years before college and it's just what you come as. So probably recruited as a goalkeeper. You know, there's times in training that I thought I was a center forward and thought I was really good, and really I wasn't. But yeah, I was just a goalkeeper for Wingate and all that.
Outside of the memories that you had off the pitch at Wingate, do you have a favorite match from your time with the Wingate men's soccer team, or maybe a couple of specific moments?
Yeah, there's a couple. Like, I remember early on, I can't remember my first couple of years, we went away to Tusculum in Tennessee, and a couple of players got sent off, and it was just a crazy game, just, you know, fights, yeah, all over, you name it, it went on. And you know, playing 9 against 11 against, and at the time, I'm sure they're still out at the time, Tusculum were a top side and full of good players. And I think, you know, to go there and to beat them two players down was good. I think we talk about that a lot. And again, there's some stuff that we can probably talk about, and there's some stuff that you get together with some of the boys and players and talk a little bit differently about it. But some of those memories, I mean, I hold them close. And then, you know, other games where we've beaten big teams, or we've won in penalty shootouts or things like that. Yeah, there's loads of good memories. And I think, you know, the older you get, you remember those over the bad ones, over the games where you fell short and different things like that. But yeah, there's loads of good memories. And I think, you know, I know this sounds a little bit canned and corny, I think some of the memories aren't always attached to me, right? Like, you think about, I played with a lot of players that were really good, right? And you look back at, you know, like at the time, like Adam Denton, you don't realize how good he was. I think he was an All-American, like your Paul Kostic, your Robert Dawson's, your Tarek's, your Ben. I mean, Gary Kinnean, who obviously was a coach on the men's side at Wingate and the women's side, now he's doing his thing in the coaching world, you know, in professional soccer and all that stuff. I mean, some of the players I've got to play with and watching them achieve what they achieved, and you know, that's the goal that this person scored. I remember this guy's game was brilliant. So I do actually think about a lot of those things. It's not just about my memories or my saves. It's more about, I remember when he scored his 20th goal of the season. And, you know, 1 year, Ben Hill just couldn't stop scoring. And, you know, there's another two-time All-American, Ben Bostic, same thing. Like, just, I remember those, and you think, yeah, I've played with some ridiculously good players. I know now what I know. Like, some of these players that have come through Wingate, not just in my, you know, little time, but since then, the guys that have gone on to the pros, they get, like, there's been some exceptional talent that's come through. And I think sometimes that can get lost in just how good the players that came through there have been. And again, it comes back to the boss in terms of his recruitment, his way he handles us with real love, tough love, honesty, all of the above. Like, again, there's no coincidence that it keeps happening.
Yeah, I mean, we just had somebody last year, Paul Ngongo, freshman record at Wingate for goals in a season. And so, it's been...
And that's not a little record, by the way. If you look at what he had to beat, there's been some absolute big goal seasons have been out there. It's not like he had a small target. There were big targets to beat. So the fact that he knocked a couple of those names off that list is even more impressive.
Yes, certainly. It's... One of the most coveted goalies as well, you know, obviously yourself, but Pablo Jara recently got a lot of recognition.
Never heard of him. Now, I've followed his career a lot. He is again, for me, I'll take my hat off. I think he is legit. I think he's going to have as long a pro career as he wants. He is a top level goalkeeper and a good person too.
You've spoken to Pablo Jara a couple of times?
Yeah, watched him play probably 25 times now. I follow all the boys' careers a lot. Top player. He's exceptional.
What's maybe one of the best things he does as a goalie in your eyes?
There's a couple of things. So, you know, in terms of his ability with the ball at his feet, second to none. And I think that's sometimes what can separate in this sort of modern incarnation of the game. His ability with his feet is ridiculous. He's as good as anyone I've seen. Mm-hmm. And the other part is he's really humble. He's a leader. I think his teammates respect him. I think he does what he's got to do. And sometimes these people talk a big game. I think he can talk it. He can walk it. All of the above. So for me, I think he's exceptional. And furthermore, he's probably sick of people saying this. If he was 3 or 4 inches taller, he would be in the major league without a doubt. He's that good.
Wow. I certainly don't doubt your judgment on that, for sure. That's really cool to hear. Philip, when you think about just your memories off the pitch, I mentioned, you know, some of the things that you really cherish about your time on the pitch, but what do you remember about the campus life, some of the things that just made the Wingate community so special in your time here as a student athlete?
When people ask me about it, right, it's not an advert for Wingate, right? I mean, I'm talking to Wingate people, so everyone's going to nod their head. Is that, especially for athletes that get to look at, you know, another, over the course of 4 years, I've probably played on 20 different Division II campuses. No campus comes close in terms of how it looks, just aesthetically. Just it's a beautiful campus. It's well maintained. There's historic elements. There's modern elements. So just from being in a place where it's not doom and gloom, and you go to some other schools and you're like, how do they get people to come here, right? Like, you look around and say, this is not very nice. But then the moment you drive onto Wingate, there's not a backside that they don't take care of. All of it's thing. I mean, so I look at that, and, you know, anyone that's asked me in the past, hey, what do you think? I'm like, well, listen, first off, in terms of that side of things, I don't think you're going to see a more beautiful, small, private campus in the United States. It's beautiful. You know, the other thing I remember that I still think holds today every time I'm back on campus is, so I come from a place in England, right, where if I don't know you, I'm not going to talk to you. It's not because I don't like you. You know, you'd never walk past someone and say, good morning. You know, they're like, I don't know you. What are you saying good morning to me for? And, you know, I just remember for the first month, people say, how are you doing? And I'm like, what are you talking to me? Like, what are you? And, you know, I just remember like being like, this is amazing. I'm in this place where, you know, people just stop and say hello to you. They'll talk to you. They'll give you the time of day. Not that anyone back home wouldn't. It's just not something you do. So it's like a cultural adjustment. So for me, I think about, I would have struggled at a place with 50,000 students or 20,000 students. It just would have swallowed me up. And I was always hanging on academically as it was. But the fact you've got this beautiful little place with a welcoming culture, with people that are kind and people that just will go out of their way to help you and say hello to you. And then that coupled with, you know, genuinely, again, it's not in some brochure, genuinely knowing your professors, genuinely being able to knock on a door and say, hey, I know I got a bad grade, but can you help me with this and this? And what do you think? That's a real thing. So that my memories off the field are really about the place. Like I still want to live there now. You know, I still want to get me old Jefferson apartment back and, you know, all that stuff. So it's, I've got nothing but amazing things to say.
That's interesting insight. The whole walking around campus. Hey, how's it going? That being an adjustment. You talking to me? that's funny to hear.
So
that.
So strange. So strange.
Yeah. Philip, couple more questions here. I'm curious about this one because your first coaching job out of school was at Wingate, right? Is that correct?
Yeah. I mean, I think I'll say it tongue in cheek, though, right? Like I've always known I've wanted to coach. Even before I came here, I'd gotten on the coaching ladder in terms of qualifications. So I got a jump start on that stuff. But I was so honored to be able to spend a semester with Gary and learn from him and learn a lot myself. You know, I think he would probably help me admit that it wasn't because I had this job on me. It was because I wasn't quite going to graduate in time. And I think when you're in one of those boats, you've got to kind of earn your keep a little bit. And I think, so I was fortunate while I had a couple extra classes to take, Gary let me hang around and I'm sure I annoyed him most of the time, with ideas and what do you think about this? Or I've seen this or that. And, you know, but it was just a good first step on the ladder. Something I'm grateful for. Yeah, and it was great to work with Gary Hamill, Gary Cunneen, you know, even with the women's coach at the time, a little bit with their goalkeeper. So it was great. It was awesome experience right out of the gate.
Yeah, and that was the very beginning. And so when you look back, you know, right now as the full-time goalkeeper coach for the U.S. Women's National Team and all the years, I mean, you've got so much experience across so many different levels, from the UNC Charlotte assistant coach, executive director of the Lake Norman Soccer Club. I mean, I could go on and on, but it started at Wingate. And I think that's really awesome that you not only played here, but your first coaching gig was with Wingate as well. What's your reaction when you hear that, just, you know, reflecting on where it started?
Well, my reaction is that, you know, there's a real affinity to Wingate. Like I hope that comes across. And I think, I'm sure it's the same as all Wingate alumni, but I'm sure it's similar to all alumni of all their schools. Is sometimes you don't really fully appreciate the things that you were given or the opportunities you were provided until you kind of get out of there and you move on a little bit and you get to pause and look back and think, you know, why were people like, you know, Bill Nash so good to me? Why were people like, again, Dr. Nancy Randall so good to me? Or there was a guy, Professor Travis Teague, you know, Dennis Johnson, like these people, they, you know, it's more than a job. And you look back and you think, well, they were so kind, they were so helpful, they were so honest and upfront, that you look back and you think about everything that Wingate's given you from a soccer experience to bring you here, to the facilities they have, to the support they have. So I think it's one of those things, as you get older, you tend to stop and pause and reflect a little bit. And, you know, that I make a point of texting the boss every few months just to say thank you. You know, sometimes I'm playing in the back garden with my kids and I'm like, when did this all happen? And, you know, I'm like, hey, this is because you took a chance to bring me here. I'll never forget that. I'm grateful for it. And, you know, and every single conversation I text is, if there's any way I can repay you, please just let me know. So yeah, I think upon reflection, it's brilliant. And I think, you know, when I'm old and gray and they need an assistant coach somewhere, I think that it would be nice to finish my journey at a place like Wingate too. But yeah, it's funny when you look at it, it's the first place I'd ever been in this country. It's the first place I'd ever coached in this country. And, you know, it would be a really cool story if it's the last place one day, you know?
Certainly. And one of the other things I can't forget that's made Wingate special to you is you met your wife here. You know, can you explain just how that came about? When did that happen when you were on campus here?
Yeah, I think she probably felt sorry for me. Just walking around lost and not understanding why people were saying good morning to me. And no, it's, you know what? I think that, and again, she probably watched this, or anyone that knows me will watch this. But you know, I think we all look back and we all evaluate where we are. And I think that I've made some, good choices with career and different things and some mistakes with different things. But one area of my life that I've absolutely got no regrets and nailed down and overachieved is met my beautiful wife, Melissa, at Wingate. And you know, we it's funny that we have our little kids and they talk about, hey, do you think that would be good for us to go to Wingate? And it's, so yeah, I remember the day I met her. I remember where I met her. I remember everything. And, I've got to say that because obviously she's going to watch. But yeah, it's for me, I think it just makes my story even better. You know, it's just another tie, another connection back to the place. So yeah, we met there and still here and still Bulldogs.
We could have some future Bulldogs then, it sounds like.
I hope so one day. I hope so.
A couple more for you, Philip. So wait, do you remember exactly where you met your wife on campus, the spot?
I do, exactly where. And you know what? I've got the coordinates written down. I keep saying, you know, one day I'm going to get like a tattoo somewhere just to, you know, on my heart or something corny like that, like the coordinates. So it was, I hope it's still there. So it was Jefferson Apartments where the sand volleyball court was. There was a little pathway that just walked right past it. It was right there and she'd actually gotten her shoe stuck in the mud. So the gentleman that I am, the savior, the, you know, Cape Crusader, I went over and I said, you know, what are you doing here? You've got one shoe on. And she said, well, it fell off in this puddle. I'm like, well, get in there and get it. Like, what do you want me to do? And she gave me this look. So I got in there, ruined my own shoes doing it. But yeah, that's how it all happened. So I met on a rainy day in a puddle in Jefferson Apartments. And now we've got three beautiful daughters and two crazy dogs and a lifestyle that I would I cherish with everything that I have. And it comes way before work and way before anything else. So yeah, it's just that I remember exactly where, I remember exactly when. And wow. You know, that's our story.
That's Philip. That's tremendous that you remember that so vividly. That's really, really awesome. All right. One other thing I've got to ask. So our league, the South Atlantic Conference, actually recently just announced the spring plan for our spring sports, or for our fall sports to play in the spring. Things are crazy right now. My head's spinning. What would be your advice during this time to the current Wingate men's soccer student athletes who have been going through a very unprecedented time? Of course, also so many student athletes are going through it, but for the men's soccer players at Wingate and women's soccer players as well. In fact, you know, since you've got ties to both squads, what's your message to them during this time?
Yeah, I think, you know, my heart goes out to not just athletes, but anyone that's dealing with anything during this time, right? I mean, I think when you start taking steps back and looking at, you know, making that lens big, it can get you down and it can get to you. And I think there's a lot of people going through a lot of things. I think that's always got to be in the back of your mind, and it's got to be something that you're willing to help out with and willing to do. I think in terms of the Wingate men's and women's soccer players, I think I would choose to look at this as an opportunity. I would choose to look at it with a glass half full to say, you know, right now, and right now you have the opportunity to work and work and work and work and work. And if you are an incoming freshman, you've got the opportunity to adapt and see and feel without having to do that in competition. If you're a sophomore that got a little bit of playing time last year, then you've got the ability now to work. If you're going into that senior season and you want to emulate this long list of All-Americans we have, then right now you have time, you have resources, you have facilities, get to work. And I think the one thing that, you know, let's say a group of 18 to 22-year-olds, if there's 100 people in that group, 25 of them might take some of that on board, 75 will nod their head but won't. Those that take it on board, those that put the time in, those that do the extra, it'll pay off for them. And I think that you never want to look back with regrets. It's the worst feeling ever that I could have done more. I could have been better. I could have been stronger. I could have been nicer. I could have been a whole lot of things. So for me right now, I would say, look at it as an opportunity to get better. Look at it as an opportunity to work. And for those that actually do, for those that make those incremental steps forward every day, it'll pay off. And it may not pay off in the way that they want, but others will see it. The team will be better because you may inspire three or four players to up their game. You'll bring the whole level up. But right now, look at it as an opportunity and get to work. That's what I would say. And that's academically too. And that's
right
on themselves.
Well put, Philip. Well put. And February 25th, 2021, men's and women's soccer teams will be able to get back in action along with some of the other fall sports. Philip, thank you so much for taking some time out of your day. We really appreciate it. Congratulations on your new title, the full-time goalkeeper coach for the U.S. Women's National Team. We look forward to following your journey as one of the coaches on staff and the continued success of the U.S. Women's National Team. So excited for you, and thank you again for sharing all the memories from your days at Wingate, both on and off the pitch. It was great.
Thanks for having me, and I've told everyone connected that again, for me it's such a special place, and I have all these opportunities because of people at Wingate and Wingate University. So if there's anything I can do for you guys, just please let me know.